नमस्कार, जय हिंद एंड हेलो टू एवरीवन। दिस इज कर्नल संजय पांडे एंड अलोंग विथ मी इज प्रोफेसर सोनाली चितळकर फ्रॉम मिरांडा हाउस, दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी। वी आर हियर फॉर द फर्स्ट एपिसोड ऑन पॉलिटिको मिलिट्री डिसीजंस इन जियोपॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया सिंस 1947। इन दिस एपिसोड we are going to cover what geopolitics means to a layman, who does geopolitics belong to, where does military get involved, biggest failure and successes in geopolitics in independent India since 1947 to date, and what have been the major geopolitical events in India in these 75 years. So with this as the backdrop, I hand you over to Professor Sonali for the first part. Over to you.
Thank you, Kanal Pandey. So we are looking at what is geopolitics for a lay person. If India belongs to you, then geopolitics belongs to you too. This is the proposition that we are starting with. And yeah, at this point of time, I would say, yeah, we are in 2021 and we as citizens, rather than using the term lay person, I would say we are all citizens of the country. And in today's day, in 2021, wars are not something that are exclusively going to be fought by the military. We are seeing an expanded definition of war, and that includes fifth generation warfare, and in which knowledge of geopolitics, without going into the definition of fifth generation warfare, I will say that knowledge of geopolitics is something that every citizen of the country needs to be equipped with. This also becomes more apparent when you're looking at what is happening in Afghanistan at this point of time, which is, I would say, purely a move on the geopolitical chessboard of the world. And you see that the implications, the effects of what is happening in Afghanistan are being most painfully felt by the citizens. So, we are a democracy, India is a democracy, and each citizen, if they are aware, they are participants in this whole framework of geopolitics that we are, drawing out as a very essential element of our strategic framework for our country, for our national interest, then yes, every citizen of the country should have at least the basic knowledge of geopolitics, which I think is a severely lacking area as far as I'm talking about the normal person in the roads. While these are very discussed events, yet what is the strategic, what are the key geopolitical events in the country are not known, and that is something for which I think we would like to deepen our...
When Professor Sonali says layman versus a citizen, I will actually prefer the term layman, because they actually are laymen. Their category is layman. They have no idea. Ministry of Home Affairs has got the map of India displayed on the website. My understanding as a citizen, not a layman, as a citizen is, I should have access to all the areas within that boundary, which is being depicted. Do I have that? As a citizen, I actually want to land at the airport of Aksai Chin, book some hotels over there, maybe a taxi, a good photo shoot, and respond to that advertisement. Kuch din to guzaro mahare Aksai Chin mein. Can you go there? Do you know whether it is with us? Let me assure you, do what I have just told you, and if you actually happen to reach there, you will be 200 to 300 kilometers ahead of where army is deployed today. So when we talk about a layman and a citizen must be aware. We are talking about our generation. I am talking about anyone who was born at 12 o'clock midnight on 15th August 1947. That person is 75 years old today. He is 15 years beyond retirement had he taken a central government service and had he would have put in entire service. So, number of generals and military generations which have passed, who knows about all these things? When Sonali says that this is a fifth generation warfare, the warfare is not a domain of military anymore. It is not. It is not the foreign relations are not in the domain of foreign ministry. These turfs, these things have to be cut. There has to be a vertical and a horizontal segregation of responsibility, but at the same time, everyone has to be involved. And if a child doesn't know the realities of his own country, I'm very sure he's not going to be a very, very good citizen. So he just becomes a layman. You ask any generation, any age, anyone less than 75 years today, give him a map and say, put your finger at XIG in Sachin Valley. Military people will. So when I'm talking about citizen of India, it includes the military. So no one has got a control on this domain. The where exactly is the problem? The problem is at the root. We are not taking this seriously. Coming to the next question, where does military get involved? Who should be considered as NGO or a non-state actor in the execution of the geopolitical, I will say, game plan in India? Yeah, Sonali.
Yeah, okay. That's a very interesting question. But before that, just a small comment on your last, bit. I'm sure maps are a way of also claiming what may not be under our control. So, given that, I think it's fair enough that we have a map that shows these areas in our territory. But yeah, you're right when you say that we should know the reality also.
Sonali, you fell into a trap. And to be very honest, and just for the viewers, there are no scripts between us. There are just some questions which we just put it like this and give it to each other. Right? And she has her own response, I have mine. And this is the exact trap I had put, and I just wanted to see whether she falls. She took it. I know exactly why the boundaries are there. I know exactly what you claim may not be with you. So my question is about accountability. What have we done as a state to regain our boundaries?
Yeah.
So did we do it? That exactly is geopolitics.
Yeah, I perfectly agree that
so that's
that is a nice trap to fall into, because that is of course the what the content of our discussions would be.
Yeah.
But coming to this question about who are NGOs and what are non-state actors in geopolitics, in the geopolitical game plan in India, it's important to understand that we are not just, when we are looking at geopolitics today, we are not just looking at the government and how it is looking at the world beyond its borders and how it is looking at positioning the country as, important in, the country's interest. We discussed this in our last episode that geopolitics means you're looking across, what is across your borders as spaces. And those are dynamic spaces. And very much within those spaces, you have other governments, but you also have interconnections. For instance, it's very tempting to take the example of Afghanistan and what happened in the Middle East, because that's how you're drawing connections. So, whereas on the one hand, we have governments interacting in these areas, we also have groups. For instance, I would say the ISIS is a group. I would say it belongs to the category of non-state actors. So that is how you identify non-state actors, which are obviously not state, operatives. So that is one thing. And they are very, very powerful. They are very, very influential in geopolitics. It's also something that we need to look at. And also NGOs would again be, they do not, borders are not a sanctity for NGOs.
Today, if you are talking pro-government, so you have a leaning. If you talk anti-government, so you have a different leaning. Whether the policy is correct or not is not important. Criticizing government is important, or praising government is important. regardless of what the issue is. So this actually complicates the entire thing. So today when I say non-state actors, within the government, the people who are serving, or the journalist, or the media houses, or the industry, anyone whose action finally results in a loss to national security in the long run is a non-state actor as far as I'm concerned. But when you say that the definition of national interests has to be given out very clearly, that may be done by the government, but you still will not be able to separate these NSAs out, the non-state actors out. So if there is a bureaucrat who says that military has got no business in geopolitics, you just do what you are told to do and just execute the plans. As far as I'm concerned, he is a non-state actor. He is acting against the government, India's interest.
He will be anti-national state actor. But he will be a state actor, a bureaucrat is a state actor.
State actor, but then he This is what I'm trying to point out. When military, when citizen, when everyone needs to understand geopolitics in the way a citizen must, and if there are people who are not letting it happen, as far as I'm concerned, it's an anti-national activity. As far as the involvement of military is concerned, I would put it different way. The first part, what Sonari covered, every citizen has to have that orientation of geopolitics to understand the vulnerabilities of India. If you do not do that, you do not produce a generation which is geopolitics aware. I don't care whether he goes in corporate, or whether he goes in bureaucracy, or whether he goes in military. Their alignment has to be done academically right from the time when he opens his map. True. I only remember Aksai Chin in purple color. I only know as soon as I put a finger over there, so that is Aksai Chin. So it always remained that Shangri-La type of a land. So it can't be anymore, right? With this, I come to the next one. Maybe if you are going to talk about one biggest failure and one biggest success in geopolitics in independent India. This actually is the speciality domain of Sonali. So I will just request her to put light on this.
Yeah, let's talk about the defeat, the negatives first, because not because I like to be negative, but because chronologically speaking, we will, you know, be fitting in better that pace. So the creation of POJK, allowing at that point of time the creation of POJK, and also allowing Gilgit-Baltistan to fall under the control of Pakistan. This, I would say, was one major geopolitical failure. And to an extent, we, you know, kind of reverted. We didn't revert it, but we managed to create a success through the creation of Bangladesh. So I would say, yeah, these two were key geopolitical events that every generation would want to understand, would like to understand. And having identified that, I think it would be nice to look at a military perspective on why we were not able to, you know, in fact, cross the border. We were stopped from crossing the border, and in fact, even going up till Karachi, Lahore in 1947, and how that has impacted our country, and also the successful intervention in Bangladesh, given the fact that there was so much of so much of damage to civilian population at that point of time. I think I'll give it over to you for your perspective, for the military perspective.
To cover the last part also quickly, major geopolitical events? Because then I'll combine all the three.
I would say, for us, in the last 75 years, major geopolitical events would be starting from, I may miss something, but I'm just, recalling. So, all our, wars with Pakistan as soon as the partition happened, and how we were able to map out those wars, Then one obviously comes to what has been happening with China. So the Sino-Indian war, and you know, that is a key event which has ramifications to date. And we look at our intervention in Sri Lanka, which is, you know, Bangladesh, of course, before that, the creation of Bangladesh. And then we, you know, come down to chronologically, we would come down to our intervention in Sri Lanka, which is something I think, you know, all of us should talk about. And that would bring us back to our inability to, or our, you know, basically our moves with Nepal, with Bhutan, with Myanmar, and how, you know, we have this entire, the perception of this entire being surrounded by hostile, you know, environments, and how we have, of course, that would be opening the canvas too wide, how we look at our relations with Iran or with Saudi Arabia and the Middle East. So all these would be key geopolitical, you know, themes which we should be focusing on. Over to you.
Yeah, so this is what Sonali feels about the main major events, the biggest success, biggest failure, as also the major events post-independence to date. I would like to actually tackle the very same question which I asked her in a different way. Would any of these have been avoided had there been a geopolitical awareness and a culture across the government in all ministries, all forces, which includes the military? Would the past have been different?
I missed out one very key event, and that was India's moves with respect to Tibet, which was just something which every person interested in geopolitics should examine.
Right. So one she missed out, that is about Tibet. We have not been guided by geopolitics. We have been guided by egos and turf wars. The bureaucrats would say military has got no business to tell them about geopolitics. That is their domain. Military is to just execute. Where are all those bureaucrats and politicians who took decision for IPKF? The problem is when military says, yes, it is possible, yes, it is not possible. These are taken as ego issues by the bureaucrats. Question is, it is not a bureaucrat or a military mind. Question is, it is a nation. For the nation, was it good? If in 1947 we did not take POJK, for whatever reason, if it was not possible then, my point is, year on year thereafter, what is the effort that government has done to reclaim, regain our entire area? That is one. 65 war probably was avoidable. We cannot go back to micros now that this is what happened in 65. No, 65 is a result of bad geopolitics. Secondly, the greatest event takes place again with Pakistan 6 years hence, 71 war. The biggest geopolitical victory of India, where the bureaucracy and the military came together and created a nation called Bangladesh. Now, as far as the military and bureaucrats were concerned, this should have been the cue, probably, to get after Balochistan, to get after Gilgit, to break it further. Why did we stop there? We shouldn't have stopped. So now when you go back to the 75 years and see each event in hindsight, it is not about our going wrong in geopolitics. My point is, was there any? And the way this episode 1 has brought out numerous issues, I think they are more than sufficient to put the viewers into a research mode to find it out on their own and form their own opinion. Just to conclude episode number one, over to Sonali.
Yeah, so Colonel Pandey, in this episode, we have discussed how it is important for a lay person to have a basic idea of geopolitics, because the definition of war has changed and because we need every citizen to be a strategist. So therefore, we need to know how geopolitics is being shaped nowadays. We also discussed this little point about how NGOs and non-state actors are to be defined, and of course we need to make a distinction between anti-national state actors, anti-national you know, non-state actors. And what I, before I use the term anti-national, I would also like to say we need to basically arrive at a definition of national interest which should not be debatable, you know, and in that of course we need to look at how we can look at policies which are, it makes it easier to understand what is an anti-national posture then. Okay, then we spoke about how POJK and how the Indo-China border dispute is shaping up, and how that was a strategic area, geopolitically a very key area where we should have, you know, gone and we should have established conditions for national interest. We looked at how, you know, we will be looking at details on these in our forthcoming episodes. We also looked at the creation of Bangladesh, and we also outlined how major geopolitical events of the past have shaped up, and which will be the content of our forthcoming episodes. And overall, your position that it is important for the military, in fact, to, you know, get its grip on, and it's important to come together with academics and with the military and with decision-making policy makers to actually get into the nitty-gritty of, you know, national interest and establishment of national interest.
Yeah, thank you, Sonali. And with this, we now go over to our next episode, which is going to be very interesting. We are going to be talking very specifically about POJK and our China border, and most important, Tibet. Thank you so much for being with us, and thank you, Sonali.
Thank you, Ram.